You're about to enter into a new world of knowledge, curiosities, and high strangeness. This is a podcast of Straight Up Strange Productions.
You're listening to Mysteries and Monsters. I'm your host, Paul Bestall. We take a wander around the United Kingdom in the company of one of Britain's leading paranormal researchers, Dr. Paul Lee. We discuss the perils of dogma on both sides of the paranormal divide, along with some odd encounters and the haunted hospitality sector too. But before that, of course, don't forget you can support Mysteries and Monsters by signing up at patreon.com/mysteriesandmonsters. $4 a month gets you ad-free episodes, guaranteed early releases, bonus content, and more. You can also click the link in the show notes as usual. Thank you to my latest patrons, Martin and Carrie, and thank you to each and every one of you that continue to support me and the show with your contributions. It means a great deal. Thank you. Mysteries and Monsters is across most social media platforms. Please subscribe to the Mysteries and Monsters channel on YouTube. You can also visit mysteriesandmonsters.com for episodes, news, and links. Our exclusive merchandise site is available through TeePublic, and you can find the link for that in the show notes, which would make perfect Christmas presents, one suggests. And our intro and outro music are performed by the marvellous Weary Pines. Thank you as always to Dean Bestall for his marvellous artwork. The show is produced by Brennan Storr of the Ghost Story Guys, and Mysteries and Monsters is delighted to be a part of the Straight Up Strange Network. Now, let us join Dr. Lee as we delve into the mysterious world of the paranormal. We head out on the hunt for some of the UK's most haunted hospitality venues in the company of Dr. Paul Lee. He holds a first-class degree in physics and a doctorate in nuclear physics. And Dr. Lee has long held an interest in the field of the paranormal. And I am delighted to welcome him to Mysteries and Monsters with a long overdue first appearance. Paul, welcome to the show.
Hello, how are you?
I'm very well. How's yourself?
Yeah, I'm doing fine, thanks. Just reclining on my bed and just relaxing after a day.
Yep. Well, it's not the strangest place I've done an interview with someone, Paul, so you're in good company there.
Well, maybe next time I might have some of your other interview locations.
Absolutely, absolutely. I know before I started the interview properly, Paul, I think you're probably one of the best researchers of paranormal investigations in the UK that most people aren't aware of. I think your way of working and your books that you've released so far are fabulous for anybody with an interest in hauntings and history and a nice bit of geography and an opportunity to go out and about and travel and visit some of these locations. Does it sometimes surprise you when you seem to keep being rediscovered, Paul? Because I've known about you for several years.
God, how can I answer that? Well, I'm always around. I don't tend to disappear. So there must be there. You've actually asked a question that I don't know how to answer. I've always been around for people to find, and very rarely people do actually contact me. They just seem to regard me as someone who scuttles around in the background and occasionally frequents boards like the 14er boards, the X40 and Times board, occasionally on the social media, mainly on Facebook, but I'm starting to find my ground on X and Blue Sky. Yeah. So I'm always looking for people to contact if they want. But I think having seen some paranormal shows and the ego that's involved, I think making a big name for yourself isn't necessarily a good thing, because a big ego normally means a nebulosity, if that's a word, and a nebulosity of ideas and original content. So I'm quite happy to work in the background and just occasionally poke my head above the parapet, so to speak, when the need arises. But I don't have a huge ego, to be honest. So I'm not like certain people who, if they don't get the quota of television or radio or podcast appearances each month, they fly into a paroxysm of angst and anger. I'm not like that at all. I'm very modest and unassuming these days. I try not to pick fights with people because I think, what's the point?
Yes.
some people do like to pick fights with me. My local ghost group they're baying for my blood at the moment. Well, I exposed them as being a bunch of money grabbers. They were artificially inflating their prices for investigations by 400%. And I put this on Facebook and I started getting a huge torrent of abuse from them, which absolutely terrified me. And I've been living life as a hermit for the last year or so. I'm almost afraid to go out into the street in case I get lynched by these thugs. And one of them even sent me a message saying, you better watch out or you'll end up as a ghost. And I thought, well, that's enough for me. So I don't tend to go out much these days. And all I did was, I just did a bit of pondering. Well, like the surveys I've done in the past, this survey was about the actual prices that venues charge compared to ghost groups charge. And I found that most ghost groups overhype and overprice their venues. And the local group are guilty of this. And all I did was just repeat my findings, and they didn't like him. And even though what I've discovered has got a basis in fact, and it's verifiable, anyone can do what I did, and they didn't like that very much. So they besmirched my good name, send out these horrible threats. And now my wife, who doesn't know much about what's going on, she sometimes says to me, why don't we go into town and stop living like a hermit? I thought, you really don't want to know what's going on. So I see, I'm not the kind of person to pick fights. I'm just unassuming these days.
I think that's the thing, Paul, with a lot of this, is that, first of all, I don't understand how anybody feels that they're qualified enough to offer a bespoke paranormal experience, regardless, because there are no experts in this field. The vast majority of ghost hunting teams around the world do not use the scientific method. They're often desperate for anything to be classed as paranormal, and often will cherry-pick evidence to match what they want to occur. And so I don't think you've said anything out of turn. Anybody with half a brain who's interested in the paranormal can do exactly what you've done, and they will come to the same conclusions because the evidence are there. If you go direct to the venue, it's always, always cheaper.
Yes, absolutely right. And a lot of the venues themselves charge minimal costs. There's a few that charge an absolute fortune. And they will admit privately that they had no ghostly experience at all, but they charge thousands of pounds. But nearly all the venues I contacted, well, I did it in a two-step process. The first one was as Paulie, the researcher, and I was asking about any recent ghost reports. And the other one was just my alter ego, which was someone who ran a paranormal events group. And that guy's that I asked them about their pricing policy, and I asked for things like VAT and number of attendees and costs, hours that people are allowed to visit and whatever. So it was like I had a proper business set up, and I kept these two visages, these two facades, completely separate. And very often what I'd find is that places that admitted to me as a researcher, Paul Lee, said, no, we've had no ghost at all. They would say to my commercial alter ego, they would say, oh, yeah, we've got ghosts and we charge so much per hour and it's 7 hours ago at 30 people attendees maximum. So they are somewhat guilty of overhyping their venue to bring in the punters. But on the other hand, I must say that a lot of the venues, whether they are admitted to having ghosts or recent reports of ghosts or not, they charge minimal costs. And a lot of them are actually good value for money. There's a local museum around here, and they charge something like £200. But the that's for 20 people over 6 hours or so, 6 or 7 hours. And when you work out the mathematics per person per hour, it's actually good value for money. When you get a group that's charging, that's about £10 a head. But when you get a group like the local group who charge £35 or £40 per person per head, you think that's a three or 400% markup in price, and they can't justify that in terms of insurance, petrol, publicity, or anything like that. it's just going straight into their back pocket. Going back to what I was saying, well, a lot of the venues, the price they charge are actually very good value for money. It works out to be a couple of quid per person.
Yeah.
And a lot of these places are really struggling to survive. And I don't really begrudge them making a bit of a hoopla about their haunted heritage, even if it is bunkum, because they need money to survive. But when you get certain castles in Newcastle that charge well over £1,000 for a group, and 20 years ago they only charged about £100, you think they're just doing it for commercial reasons. They're not doing it to further the field of study, and it's just it's obviously it's greed that drives these people.
Absolutely.
It's just thinking about it, it just makes me feel quite angry sometimes. I say some places actually do need the money to survive. They don't get a government grant. They don't have a very good footfall. So if they are exaggerating things a bit, I'm sort of happy with that. I'm happier than the larger venues, which charge thousands of pounds. And then the ghost groups come along and overprice it by 300%, 400%, 500%. It just goes into their back pocket.
I think it's one of those things, like you say, I've obviously been aware of certain locations. I know exactly where you're on about in the northeast, by the way. And so I've seen it all over the place where prices have quadrupled, and sometimes there are certain locations that their reputations precede them. And there is a very famous home here in Yorkshire, well, in West Yorkshire to be exact, where the vast majority of researchers and investigators who are balanced and interested in the phenomenon will say, there's absolutely nothing happening here. It's all based on the original story from the 1960s. And yet, you know, the prices they charge, they're eye-watering. And I know that the next-door neighbour, on occasion, bangs on the wall, Paul. And I know that for a fact. And that's never been reported generally. And so I have to question sometimes the, not necessarily the honesty of certain locations, but some certainly play up to a reputation that doesn't seem to exist anymore, or a phenomenon that doesn't certainly seem to be happening anymore. And I suppose doing the research you've done in the books that you've done and the ghost maps you've done, it's interesting for me how this still seems to be perpetuated more in the modern era, I think, with the plethora of ghost hunting groups that are all over the place. And sometimes even I'll see stories here in my local paper, and you can see that they're just grasping on the modern YouTube version of a haunting rather than the actual historical basis for it. Or in some cases, they're just making things up. And so I suppose for people who are new to this particular topic or are wanting to sort of spread their wings a bit, Paul, you have to tread a fine line, because you can go into it with the best of intentions, but there will always be people out there who are happy to take advantage of the naive and the inexperienced.
Absolutely. It's quite disgraceful sometimes. There are a lot of opportunists out there who want to exploit the gullible. And by the way, I think I recognise which venue you're talking about in Yorkshire. When you said banging on the wall, I thought, yeah, that has a resonance with me. I think I know which one that is. A lot of ghost groups, particularly the modern ones, have taken all of their cues from TV shows and YouTube broadcasts. And the progenitor seems to be most haunted. That is the template for most ghost hunts these days. You have a medium wandering around, and you have whizzy gadgets. You may or may not have a skeptic, a cynic, to offer some balance of reason to the proceedings. But what you see in these programs is a medium who will spout stuff that either can be verified from historical records, or they're going to say something which can't be verified by historical records. So in other words, I'm thinking, why on earth are you using them then if they're going to say something which is practically of no value at all? They're just providing lip service. They're going to be giving out information, and all you can do is record it, and hopefully these researchers will go away and comb through the historical records and try and verify this. Now, very often they do not succeed. They can't find any corroboration, so maybe the psychic's making it up. But very often the researchers just accept in blind faith what the mediums have said and leave it. They just think it's sacrosanct information, and they don't even bother to try and debunk or confirm or verify what they've been told. So what they're spouting is taken as gospel information, which is completely the wrong way of doing it. When I was researching my book on West Norfolk, I tried to go back to original historical documents if they survived, or the original ghost reports. And the original ghost reports are very different to what is being reported these days.
Mm.
And if you dig back even further, you find that a lot of the information that's been purported as coming from the great beyond has got no basis in historical reality whatsoever. You can't find any verification for it. And yet it's still being spouted as truth. Another thing that you see on these ghost hunts is the overuse of whizzy gadgets. The field meter is a favourite one. Now, I haven't done as much research on this as I would have liked. And that's to my great shame, to be honest. But I've learned enough to realise that these things are very prone to reacting to false positives. And this is never mentioned. It's assumed that every time these things beep or a light goes off, it's due to a ghost. But these things can be subverted by any kind of stray magnetic field, Wi-Fi routers. I even read a report not so long back that malfunctioning neon tubes can set them off.
Hmm.
If you go into a room and you can hear a hum and the neon tube is about to blow and it's audibly making this sound, then this can interfere with certain types of magnetic field meters. So what people should do is they should do a lot more research into how these things can react to false positives. And that's never done. They just assume that every time something happens, it is definitely due to a ghost. EVPs, I'm not too keen on, unless you can prove to me that they haven't been the cause of some kind of interference or hoaxing. And a lot of them are just so submerged in electronic noise, you can't make them out. And yet these are being offered as definitive proof of the afterlife. I've seen YouTube videos of people with EVP recordings, and they've downloaded an audio piece of software off the internet. And what they've done is they've just flicked through various buttons, moved slider bars, until they get something which is vaguely intelligible. And I'm wondering if these people have ever had any training in acoustics. Do they actually know what they're doing? Or are they just pressing buttons in the hope that they will get something? That's not evidence. That's just blind hope, really. I'm not too keen on ghost hunts. But the historical form of ghost hunts, which weren't investigations, they were called vigils, must seem very pedestrian and very mundane and boring by today's standards. Because basically you just sat in a room with a notepad and pen and a torch and you waited for things to happen. There was no medium or no invigilator to call out to the ghosts to make things happen. In other words, it wasn't a very active method of doing things. It's a very reactive way of appealing to ghosts. And a lot of vigils produce nothing at all. They are so boring, very rarely that things happen. But that is the way that things were done up until Most Haunted happened. You just sat in the dark and hoped that things would happen. You had your video cameras and your tape recorders and whatever, but you didn't have anything more than that. And I just think that there's too much show business in ghost hunts these days, and perhaps we should get right back to basics.
I completely agree. I think often, as with anything, it's a bit like Keeping Up with the Joneses, Paul, that often people will see certain shows, certain YouTube channels, certain social media profiles where somebody's got, they'll have their laser grids and they'll have their REM pods and they'll have their EVP recorder and they'll have their EMF detectors. And I'll guarantee you they don't know how any of that stuff works. They've got no training in electronics. They've got probably no historical data. They don't know where the wiring is. They don't know where the waterworks are. There are so many things that can cause reactions in any kind of electrical measuring device, regardless.
No, I was just going to say, there's no scientific basis for a lot of the equipment that is deployed these days, other than they're just jumping on the bandwagon of others using it, like laser grids, for instance. I think, well, why are they using laser grids? And the answer is because everyone else is using them. I think that is not a reason to deploy this equipment. Yes. You should have a theoretical basis as to, first of all, what is it you're trying to achieve, and why do you think ghosts are going to try communicating this method? That's why I'm very skeptical about EVPs. Is there some kind of theoretical basis that will explain how ghosts can directly imprint information onto magnetic tape or onto electronic media without being detected by the human participants? And none at all. Everyone uses EVPs because everyone else does it. No one sits back and thinks, oh God, does this really make sense, or are we looking like a bunch of buffoons, really? And I just, it's frustrating, really. And a lot of these groups are trying, it's like a one-upmanship. They're trying to, they have the best equipment compared to other groups, or they have the best venues, or they have the best mediums. I think just forget all of that that bunkum, just forget it and get back to basics. If that means sitting in the dark with a pen and a notepad, just waiting for things happen, so what? Because if you're using EVPs or using magnetic field meters or whatever, or laser probes or whatever for temperatures, there's just so many ways these can provide false positives that no wonder the scientists think it's all a load of bull and they're laughing at you, because it just, it's not convincing. It's not a proper scientifically rigorous fashion. And it's laughable in most cases.
Yes. Well, I think this is the thing. Because as we're having this conversation, Paul, people will say, well, this is very sceptical. What are these two talking about? I thought we were talking about ghosts. But I think we're very much on the same page here. And most good ghost investigators are exactly the same as ourselves, Paul. They will ignore all the modern paraphernalia and bumf, which is irrelevant, in my opinion, because it often, I mean, this is the other aspect. I know for a fact that some of them are designed to give false positives. They will, if you let them run long enough, they will start to create a pattern. You can see that it's on a loop. And so it's always going to do that. Laser grids especially are a prime example of this. But I think the fact that we can still be so fascinated by the paranormal, despite our disregard for the modern way a ghost hunt is often portrayed, I think shows that we are actually interested in this particular phenomenon, because it's this fakery and exaggeration that infuriates us when we know, especially in the UK, there is a body of work and a history that permeates each corner of the United Kingdom and every bit in between that doesn't need exaggeration. And therefore, these people are simply portraying a version of a ghost investigation, which, to be fair, now has no basis in reality. There's no factual supporting evidence for anything they do.
Absolutely right. It's like a parody.
It is.
Just thinking about it just makes me a little bit, it makes me more than angry, to be honest.
Yes.
They're not jumping on the paranormal most haunted bandwagon. And I term these people most haunted wannabes. I've used that term for many, many years, because they're just following the same recipe that Yvette Fielding and the rest of them have done years ago.
You can always spot the ones that are trying to appeal to the American audience as well, Paul, because they're always finding demons.
Oh, God, yes. Shadow people and things like that, and black-eyed children, and the latest trope of the 14 message boards or whatever. Yeah, well, they've just appeared in the last few years. Where did they come from, I wonder? And that's where it's American mythology. Yeah, they're trying to appeal to the American market.
Yes.
Like in the 1990s, just after the internet blew up, I was at university, and I used to spend hours rather than studying, reading purportedly true ghost stories. And there was an American lady, and she had archived a lot of them. And just reading through it, they were a lot more demonic and a lot more sinister than the British comparable ghost stories. You get a lot of demonic stories, a lot of Indian burial grounds. That's another good one. And I read these and I thought they're all following a similar theme, whereas the British ones are very much more benign. The American ones are more malevolent. They're almost evil, and they were actually more exciting to read. So I read the American ones instead. And then I thought I should be getting back to work. But I spent hours and hours going through them. But I want to say something about me coming across as an arch skeptic of these things. I'm not. I have a genuine interest in the paranormal. And I don't know where that comes from. It started at a very early age. And people knowing my scientific background, they're quite surprised to realize that I have an interest in ghosts. And I say to them quite honestly, I say, if I thought it was all a load of old rubbish, I would not waste my time on it. I say to them, I don't know what ghosts are. I've only encountered a few things which might be paranormal, but I've known of trusted people who have experienced things which defy explanation. And these are people from, well, security guards, to high court barrister, to artists, to any walk of life. They have encountered bizarre things, and I trust them. And I'm not in the mood to call my friends liars or people who exaggerate. I don't know much about the psychology of ghost reports, to be honest. But I do know that when someone sees a pint glass fly off a shelf and it goes halfway across the room, then psychology can't explain that. Ghost sightings might be explainable in some respect by psychological aspects. But I say to these people, I'm not going to call my friends who I trust and believe liars. They've seen something which defies explanation. It's left them really rattled. And I say to people, if I thought this was all a load of old crud, I would not waste my time on it. I'm convinced that there is something there that is worth investigating. And I say that to people just to convince them that I'm not an arch skeptic. I am interested. I just don't know what it is that's going on. And I always get asked that question by the media, and they always seem to be disappointed when I say to them that I don't know what ghosts are. And then they say, do you believe in ghosts? And I say to them, well, define what a ghost is, and then maybe I'll know. They get disappointed with these so-called evasive answers. But it's the truth.
Yes.
I do know what a ghost is, and until one is defined, how can I answer that question? Hmm? I've only encountered a few things which might be odd. And not enough to convince me that I've seen something definitely paranormal, but enough to make me intrigued. And that intrigue has lasted all my life.
Well, I think this is often the thing. And it's a fine line that the people like ourselves walk, Paul, because we can look at it as balanced as we can and consider all the evidence. And like you say, often people will always prescribe it as being a purely psychological response. But if there's physical items being moved around and multiple witnesses and things like that, then it kind of ignores it. And sometimes people will focus on trying to explain something psychological, and then they don't care about the rest of the stuff that can't be explained. There are numerous cases like this throughout, even in this country: Battersea, Enfield, Sorky in Scotland, Pontefract, Cardiff, the ghost of the boy that lived in that garage, the one in Manchester, that people say, oh, well, everybody involved, they're all making it up, and it's all perhaps it was a very stressful environment. And it frustrates me sometimes because you have two sides to this. You have this where people will explain something away and say, well, it's all in their mind, and therefore, but I don't want to explain anything else. Therefore, as far as I'm concerned, I've explained that, and that explains everything else, which is daft. But then you've also, as we've been saying, you've also got these groups who will accept any old nonsense or even pretend that things have happened as proof of it. Whereas we will go, well, hang on, you can't say that with no evidence, but you can't dismiss that with that evidence. And therefore, I find it equally frustrating on both sides. And I think when you're a doctor or something like that, regardless of the field that you specialise in and that you've got your doctorate in, Paul, I can see this, that people will come at you from both sides and think, well, how can you think like this? Like you say, because of your scientific background, people will presume that you will explain this away. It's all stuff and nonsense and whatever. But I genuinely think that there's something to this. And it's very difficult to pick through the mixed messages we get from both, because arch skeptics and arch believers are two sides of the same coin. They don't think they are, but they are exactly the same, because they are so enmeshed in their dogmatic reasoning behind what they think is going on, that everything else doesn't matter. And therefore, you will often see the most ludicrous explanations put forward for paranormal phenomena, as much as the most ludicrous explanations to say why there's paranormal phenomena going on. And so we walk this tightrope in between it where we think, well, yeah, look, that's probably not true, but you can't say that's all in the mind. If somebody's smashed the door in, that's not somebody, that's not going on in somebody's mind. That's a physical action that's occurred here. And so yeah. Something must have happened. It's often the same that, oh, well, these people must be on medication. They must be mentally ill. They must have bipolar disorder. Is a lot of it seems to be written off as mental health crises these days by certain people. But once again, that doesn't often take into account the body of evidence. As with believers, some skeptics will cherry pick evidence and ignore everything else that doesn't matter. And I would imagine for you as a man of science, that's the most infuriating thing that anybody can do, regardless of which side of the coin they're coming at here, because the evidence is the evidence. Whether you decide to ignore it or not, or you believe it or not, the evidence is the evidence. You can't just take the bit you want, because either way you're doing that, you're not fulfilling the criteria of doing an investigation, if that's the case.
Yes, but then the problem then is the quality and the quantity of evidence that you get in the past, where we have vigils rather than investigations. You had eyewitness reports and a video camera and a tape recorder, if you're lucky. And very often the evidence wasn't very convincing. Nowadays, you have reams and reams of EVPs and whatever. And it leaves you with a sense of despondency, really, because we've been bombarded with a lot of evidence, so-called evidence. The quality leaves a lot to be desired. So who is to be an arbiter as to what is convincing evidence and which is unconvincing evidence? Like I say, I'm very skeptical of EVPs, for instance, unless it's absolutely crystal clear and there was no chance of any kind of audio contamination. But someone might produce a fantastic of an apparition walking down the stairs, and you can spend hours and hours trying to debunk it and fail. And you could say that is very, very good evidence. On the other hand, they might provide somewhat fuzzy video material, which isn't convincing. So who is to say what is convincing and what isn't? So it's not just a matter of a lot of evidence. It's a case of what is convincing, what would be convincing to a skeptic, for instance. And what we have so far that is unambiguous is so poor. It wouldn't really, you couldn't really hang a hat on it, to be honest. Mm. We've had a lot of stuff over the last few years where even the most cherished of ghost stories have had severe doubt cast on them. Like that photograph of the brown lady, Raynham Hall, that is now on very good grounds. The photo of that bizarre figure at the church in Newby.
Yes.
Which looks really spectacularly fun. It looks amazing, but behind the scenes it sort of falls to bits when you look at it, because, well, first of all, the figure wasn't there when the photograph was taken, and the figure would have to be about 7 or 8 feet tall, and also the shape, the face seen through the cowl is a very stereotypical kind of ghost scream kind of shape. So that is something else that for years many people have described to have a paranormal origin, and maybe it doesn't. So evidence can be reassessed, and sometimes not very kindly. Mm. And we've now got technology which enables us to go back and look at all this stuff, like computers for enhancement of photographs, and we might sometimes have to dismiss some of our most cherished ghost stories.
Well, I think it's one of those things. The aspect of some of these historical cases is very similar to what happened with the Cottingley case with the fairies, because regardless of the fact that those pictures were clearly faked, because these days it's very difficult to believe anybody fell for them, Paul. But obviously it was all wrapped up in the people who wanted it to be true. And some of the questions about the origin of those particular pictures have never really been answered, because when we've been able to analyse them in the latter part of the 20th century, it's very clear that they were enhanced and taken on a different camera to the one that the girls claim to have used. So who did that? How did they do that? Why did they do that? And so then you begin to think, well, the girls obviously weren't that au fait with it, because I think we were talking about, I don't know, 10 and 12 years old they were at the time. And yet somebody somewhere created that story with a camera that they didn't have access to and cleaned the images up and made them seem even more spectacular. Obviously, I think it was in the 1970s, somebody discovered the pictures were actually cut out of a book that somebody found, and therefore you could prove it. And I don't care what anybody says about that. They're all fake. Every single one of those pictures is fake. And whether the girls involved in it changed the story, they admitted it, they'd faked it, and then they claimed it, well, we only faked the pictures because we wanted people to believe it was true. Well, that's fine. But you didn't fake those pictures. Somebody else did. And they never said why or who that was. And obviously, the biggest name attached to that particular case was Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who was determined to prove spiritualism existed above everything else after that point of his life.
Yes, when you've got a proponent of the afterlife and a spirituality like Conan Doyle, obviously people are going to pay more attention to him than of the two little girls.
Yeah.
And I think even they admitted it in interviews later on. They said it was like a prank that got out of hand. And when Conan Doyle came along, they realized that they had to run with the prank. They didn't want him to look like a complete buffoon. Mm. So they had to keep going with it. So for decades later, they propagated this myth that they had conceived, because they didn't want this great man, this creator of Sherlock Holmes, to be lampooned as a gullible half-wit.
Mm.
I mean, Conan Doyle did a lot of great work, both in a literary sense and also in judiciary sense.
Mm.
And this would have been very, very embarrassing to his followers if it had come out that he had been fooled by two very young girls. So they kept their mouths shut. Now, morally, did they do the right thing? I don't know. But it's what kept the mystery going for decades. If it hadn't been for Conan Doyle coming along, it might have lasted a couple of years and then they might have confessed. But with Conan Doyle in the wings, They couldn't ridicule this great man.
Hmm.
It's a very interesting case. And you're right, someone did enhance at least one of the photographs. I think they rubbed over the glass negative with Brasso or something to bring out the image quality a bit more. And they think that might be a member of the local community who was very much enamored by fairy stories, but of course everyone's passed away now, so we'll never know for sure.
Mm.
It is still very interesting to this day exactly what it all means, because at least one of the girls said that there were fairies at the bottom of the garden, but no one believed them, so they concocted these hoax photographs, and they didn't convince everyone, but they convinced Conan Doyle, and by then the joke had got too much. But they were insistent for years later that there were fairies, but photographs were faked just to stop the ridicule that they were getting from people. So the story in that point isn't just a case of a simple hoax. And then it comes down to the fact, well, do you believe the girls in the first place that they really did see fairies? Or was it like a mental brain fog they had, a collective hallucination? They thought they saw fairies, but they didn't really. So then you get into all this case of the psychology of fairy photographs. Were they actually really there?
Hmm. Absolutely. Well, a shared hallucination is something that seems to have come into the fore over the last few years as a way to explain things where more than one people see things, because obviously people cannot see the same thing. If they're hallucinating, even if they're on the same medication or recreational drugs, Paul, people will not hallucinate the same things. They may claim to see similar images, but they're not exactly going to be, you know, unless you can psychically see what somebody else is seeing, you're not going to see exactly the same thing, even if it is such a thing as a shared hallucination. But also you get this kind of convoluted knot of concerned parties being involved, where things, as the girls would often say in later life, things just spiraled out of control because the belief in it being real was more important than anything else at that point.
Yes, absolutely right. And going back to what you said a few minutes ago about collective hallucinations, there is the opposite side of that, where you get some people in a group and nearly all of them see a apparition or a figure, but not everyone. And Andrew Green discusses this in one of his books. I think he was Ghost Hunting, A Practical Guide. And he has got a little sketch map. He had four, and he was the one that brought this to my attention, but I'd heard stories of it in other magazines and books and whatever, and I've dug those out. And there are fascinating cases of people in a group seeing a figure, but not everyone sees it. And Andrew Green talks about four people in a group. This apparition walks by, and one of them doesn't have a clue what the other three are looking at. They all talked about seeing the same thing, but this one person just does not register it at all. Mm. I think, is he lacking some mental circuitry that makes him receptive to seeing these ghost figures? Mm. So again, that brings in the psychology. Is there some kind of interaction between the brain and the environment that we just don't know about? And that brings another case to mind, which is very local to me, of the Thetford Priory case. A friend of mine was there a couple of years back with some colleagues, and they're walking through the Priory ruins, and they saw a figure through an upstairs doorway. And then as they watched, the figure retreated and seemed to go down some stairs. Now, two of the group ran towards the figure. And not only had the figure vanished, but so had the stairs. And one of them ran full pelt into the wall of the Priory and knocked himself out.
Oh, blimey.
And he really was badly shaken up. And the other one, I think, tripped over. The other two, I think, stayed behind and just watched proceedings. But afterwards, with a very, very logical mindset, they decided to record independently what each one of them had seen. And then they compared notes. And each one of them saw something very, very different. Mm. One person saw like a monk figure. One person saw a figure wearing a skin-tight black costume. And the other one described seeing, it was like a figure with glittery points within it, like shining stars.
Mm.
I forget the full description. I can't remember what the fourth lad saw, but this one was very, he distinctly recalled seeing this shape, and it had shining little pinpoints of light. And each one saw a completely different figure. They all saw something, but they all saw something different.
Yes.
Now, is that because the mind and the environment is working in different fashion for all four of them? That's one of the theories that I've held for a long time, that there is something very complicated going on between the brain and the environment, and I don't know what is happening, which might explain why some people see ghosts and some people don't, and why you have different descriptions of apparitions.
Yeah. No, it's a theory I prescribe to as well, Paul. I think there's a lot more to this than meets the eye, ironically, and I didn't mean that in a bad pun sense. But there's clearly strange things that occur, because I'm always fascinated like that in regards to multiple witness cases, where you will get people who don't see anything and you get some people who see something and not necessarily see the same thing. And therefore, I was always kind of challenged by that kind of report, because it doesn't fit the normal parameters of what a ghost experience usually is. But then I spoke to Lloyd Auerbach, the parapsychologist from the US, who basically kind of opened me up to the theory that people aren't seeing things through their eyes, it's in their brains, and it's transposing that information somehow to the optical receptors to create the impression that they're seeing something, whereas in essence it's inside their head. It's not in their eyes. They're not seeing it physically outside of their body. They're seeing it internally, and therefore somehow the brain is creating this, I don't know, this kind of projection almost. Because often you will get these reports of people wearing clothing and things like that, and you will think, well, how can we see these? How can non-physical items be paranormal? It takes you down a rabbit hole and a pathway that is even more complicated than dealing with the question of, are ghosts real? Even if you get to that point of, yes, they are, well, then you say, well, why do some people see them and others don't? Is it something strange, like as you say, is it something to do with the way that person's brain is wired? Is it down to their blood group? Is it down to their genetic origin? There are so many things that could have an effect that we see in normal day-to-day activities without the paranormal or the Fortean being involved, Paul, that can change people's perceptions to things, even down to colorblindness, for goodness sakes, that everybody has a different level of how their senses work. Some people may have heightened senses for all kinds of reasons, and yet we have such a wide disparity in certain reports in certain locations that you think, well, there can't be like 200 different ghosts wandering around this one particular location. There must be something occurring somewhere. How or why, I don't know. Probably the same as you, Paul. But there's certainly something going on because people keep reporting them year after year after year.
Yeah. Well, going back to what you said about physical acuities, that reminds me of something that I read a couple of years back. There was a man, and he was very short-sighted. His vision was very, very blurry. And he saw a ghost or an apparition or something, and it was crystal clear, even without glasses, which makes me think that he wasn't in the environment at all. It was in his mind.
Yes.
Now, that's the only case that I've found so far of someone with visual problems experiencing something which was completely contrary to his own physical makeup, his lack of eyesight. But you've just reminded me of something that I was thinking about for quite a while, and I could never, ever reconcile this with actual physical data. Most ghost hunters these days go into an environment, and for them, every night is Halloween. They hear clicks, raps, ticks and whatever, flashes of light, and they see lots and lots of purported spectral evidence. So I think is completely bogus. But certainly in the past, most ghost hunters these days, they go into an environment and every night is Halloween. They purport to collect lots and lots of convincing evidence, but it's really quite meagre and quite scant, to be honest. But certainly quite a while back, and we're talking 1990s and I became interested, it was mentioned by quite a few people that things only tended to happen when you least expected them. Like when you were in a state of mind that was distracted or occupied by something else, where ghosts were the last thing on your mind, and then things would happen. But when you switched into a focused frame of mind for vigils or whatever, then things would stop happening. Now, I've known quite a few people, either during their work environment, like when in the office or whatever, when things would happen. But when they went looking for ghosts, they would never, ever encounter them. And with a lot of ghost hunters in those days, when people were setting up equipment or packing it away, it's then that things happened. And there are two ways of looking at this. The first one is this heightened state of mind not conducive to ghostly reports? In other words, are you actually inhibiting ghost reports by the way that your mind is focused? The other way of looking at it is that the ghosts are sentient and they're waiting till you're distracted and you don't have a tape recorder on or your video camera is broken down. They play their tricks then because they're having games, or they're playing games with us. If they are sentient, are they having a little bit of a laugh at our expense by waiting for us until we're in a not conducive state of mind and distracted and packing up or setting up, and then they play their tricks? So is it the mind, or is it some kind of sentience on their path, or a combination of the two?
Well, I would be very surprised if somebody in the afterlife didn't carry over their sense of humour, Paul.
Well, that wouldn't surprise me at all. You know, there are two types of ghosts according to common paradigm. There's the recording type of ghosts, and there's the sentient type of ghosts. And there's a chasm of evidence between them. There are two types of ghosts according to common ideology. The first one is the recording type ghost, the so-called stone tape theory. And the other one is the sentient type of ghost, the type that interacts with people and responds to them intelligently and with knowledge and with imagination.
I was trying to come with an idea of reconciling the two different kinds of ghosts, the sentient and the recording kind of ghosts. And it's like never the twain shall meet between them. You get ghosts which seem to enact the same kind of rigmarole time after time. And you get the ones which are imaginative and sentient and react to people. Mm. And why are there these two kind of subspecies of ghosts? It doesn't make any sense. Unless there's some kind of taxonomy involved, like you get various different kinds of dogs and cats, you get various different kinds of ghosts. Hmm. And then coupled in with all that, you get poltergeists as well, some of which may be connected to ghosts. You sometimes get reports of spectres with poltergeist activity. So that's like as another subset. Hmm. And then you get these recent cases of demonic entities and black-eyed children and shadow people, and where do they fit in? And they've only appeared in the last couple of years. So is this like another subgenre of ghosts? Many years ago, and we're talking hundreds of years ago, ghosts were seemingly either noisy poltergeists or recording ghosts. And yet, all of a sudden, you started getting creeping into the fray, the sentient ghosts, the ones that actually talk to you and react to you. And now, in the last few years, we are getting a whole new subset of reports. And is that significant? Are the ghosts becoming like, are they mutating? Are they becoming like a whole new species? Or are they stories of demons and shadow people? Are they just complete misidentifications?
Mm.
Just the case that people are seeing what was already there to begin with, but they're misinterpreting it. Like shadow people are normal ghosts, but they're just being identified in a completely different way. And shadow people seem to be quite much in the fore these days. And I'm thinking, why is that? Why have they suddenly come to the fore? Whereas in decades gone by, there weren't very many reports of them. Why now? Why are things changing?
Yeah, because those kinds of stories seem to hark back to sort of early Victorian encounters where you would have a ghost with a mission, Paul, who'd been murdered or wronged or had lost some treasure and had come back from the beyond to help a relative or a wronged person clear their name or such like. And then they seem to completely drift out of reporting and fashion sort of well into the 20th century. And now, like you say, I've noticed this over the last 10 years, that we've now got sort of conversational ghosts these days. And I think it's such a broad church that I think often people are trying to create, like you say, categories and taxonomies for this particular subject when we don't even know what one sort is. So why are we trying to decide what everything else is going on?
Yeah, right.
And it is one of those things. I think sometimes people get so focused on the minutia rather than the phenomenon that they try and separate everything out to the finite degree. And I think sometimes that you can't see the wood for the trees with that kind of aspect. And that kind of leads me into obviously the two books that you recently wrote in regards to the hospitality industry. And I was really interested in the second one, which is talking about hotels, Paul, because there's a lovely sentence on the back that says, unlike pubs, the managers of haunted accommodation were markedly more reluctant to divulge details of their phantom guests In many cases, we have tantalizing hints of something awry in their properties, but little else to go on. And that kind of surprised me, because I've always thought here in the UK we're a bit more sort of okay about talking about the ghosts and haunted hotels. And therefore, it seems surprising that publicans and pubs and bars seem to be a little bit more open about these things to hotels, because often most of the great ghost stories are often set in place, hotels and things. I mean, I've got personal experience of this, because on my 40th birthday, we went away for a golf weekend on the east coast of Yorkshire, and we stopped at this lovely hotel called the Revelstoke in Bridlington. And we didn't know anything about it. There was seven of us gone. And ironically, I'd taken Colin Wilson's Poltergeist book as my bedtime reading. And so I'd got this lovely hardbound copy of it by my bed, and I'd read for an hour. The first night I read it, left it on my bedside table. We went playing golf, came back, couldn't find the book anywhere. Turned the room upside down, wasn't there. So a bit strange. Day after, still looking for it, went down to reception. No, can't find it. Went back up to my room and just thought, well, I'll have one last check. And I moved everything around, and then I moved the bedside table that I'd moved both that morning and the day previously, and the book was behind it, but
wow,
it was covered in so much dust, it looked like it had been in an attic for 10 years. Wow. And I just thought, this is really weird. This is strange. And I thought, well, is somebody pulling my leg because of what the book's about more than anything? And I just thought, well, no, I've just checked this, and nobody's been back into the room since I've been downstairs and come back up. So how's this happened? But added to that, my brother and his friend were in another room, and on the I can't remember which night it happened, but his friend woke up to see him sliding feet first out of the bed. He didn't roll out of bed. He was pulled out of bed from the bottom onto the floor. And his mate said, oh, I can't believe you've just rolled out of bed like that. That's really weird. And he went, well, I've not rolled out of bed. Something's just pulled me out of the bed.
Oh, God.
But then when we went back to the hotel and explained these couple of strange things, they flatly refused to even engage in any potential conversation about the paranormal, which we thought was a bit odd. And so when I then saw that on the back of the latest hospitality book, I kind of thought, well, there you have it then, because I've been to other locations. I mean, especially as you mentioned, Paul, earlier, York, there's hardly a building in York that doesn't seem to have a ghost, whether it's a pub or a hotel or a bar or whatever, or even the local council offices. And one of the most famous ghost encounters in Britain is obviously in York. So were you surprised, this kind of duality that you'd got in the hospitality industry, that from the first book to the second book, it seemed as though you were talking to a completely different industry?
Well, I think with hotels, rather than the public house aspect, there might be a couple of reasons why people aren't happy to talk about ghosts. The first one is that it's bad for business. And I've had quite a few hotels come to me and they say, we've had no ghost reports here, but please don't mention us because it is bad for business. And the other reason is that you might find that people's ideologies just aren't compatible with the idea of ghosts.
Mm.
From a biased point of view or a religious point of view, they might just completely blank the notion out of their mental makeup because they just don't want to deal with it. They might accept that there are ghosts there, but they just do not accept it. But I think for the most part in hotels, they are reluctant to do anything that might damage their business venture. And I joke to people, I say, what could be worse than waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning to find a phantom monk bending over you? I think people would break the sound barrier trying to escape from such a bad thing. It's not too bad because you're only there for a transient sense. You're only there for a few hours having a meal or having a few drinks and then you're on your way. But with a hotel, you could be there for a couple of days and you don't want to feel entrapped by spooky stuff, particularly if it's absolutely terrifying. And I've heard of a few tales where people have actually slept in their car overnight or slept in the lounge. was the, well, where was it? The for my birthday a few years back, I stopped at the Sun Inn in Hitchin, which is a lovely little town, and I got speaking to a couple of staff, and a few of them were willing to talk about their ghostly exploits, and they said they've had people who have been so frightened by something that they wouldn't talk about that they've slept in their car in the car park. Another place is the famous Bell Inn in Thetford.
Yes.
I interrogated quite a lot of staff when we stopped there a few years back. And the night porter said very often they've had people, he's come in and they found people sleeping in the entrance foyer rather than go up to their rooms. And they've asked to be, they've either asked for a refund or they've asked for a different suite altogether. They just would not stay in their original room. And that's something you hear time and time again. People will not stay in a haunted room. But with a pub, if you're only there for a few hours, you see a ghost, might frighten you, and then you're off on your business. You don't want that in a hotel where you're effectively trapped. Like if you're in a country hotel, for instance, and you're terrorized by a spectral monk, what are you going to do? Where are you going to go? Where are you going to sleep? So they don't exaggerate. They don't try and mention their ghostly cases. And I've had a few places where they've sent information sheets, but they won't talk about any recent spectral escapades. I asked them a few times, has anything been reported recently? And they ignore that part, but they're happy to send information as to what's happened in the past. So they don't want to perpetuate or propagate this idea that they are still having ghostly problems. That's what I get from it. But there are other categories of places in the UK and around the world, like everywhere from museums to theatres. Well, even police stations, they seem to revel in their spectral history. But in a survey I did a few years back, I found that hotels were the least likely to respond to inquiries about ghosts, either past or present. Everywhere else was more or less happy to talk about it, even if it was just a simple yes or no. But with hotels, I got a very, very small response. And I just think that's the nature of the industry.
I think that might have a variety of reasons, like you say, because for me, it seems a bit peculiar that this seems to be a more modern trend. I've noticed it because obviously I would read about these kind of haunted hotels in sort of the 70s and 80s growing up, and you'd see certain programs that were around in the early 90s. I remember a very famous hotel. I can't remember the name of it now. So famous I've forgotten its name, Paul, but it featured on an episode of Strange But True, where they were interviewing all the staff and the management, and they were saying, oh yeah, there's all kinds of ghosts wandering around here and terrified previous customers and stuff. And yet, as you say, when I read this book, you know, there are a couple of places, especially close to me, that I know are haunted, but they've basically fobbed you off and said, nah, no, there's nothing going on here. And I find this change a bit peculiar. And I think, is it, like you say, I doubt everybody, there's lots of hoteliers have suddenly discovered religion over the last 20 years, because we're, if anything, we're becoming a more secular country in the UK. I suspect that you've got the negative associations of the modern ghost hunter to kind of deal with, that you don't want a group of people just running around a hotel at 3 a.m. shrieking everywhere, Paul. And also you don't know if people are going to damage it. You don't know who's going to turn up, try and cleanse your building. For example, you could have all kinds of characters turning up. So I can kind of understand it, but it's a bit of a shame, really. And I know, as I mentioned, you know, along with the books, you brought out a brilliant ghost app that you can download for your phone. And obviously, whenever I see anything like that, Paul, like your books and anybody else who writes in this particular field, I'll always look for my locality. So it'll be Yorkshire, South Yorkshire, Derbyshire, North Nottinghamshire, anywhere fairly local to me. I'll always have an interesting look. And so when I was looking at your app, I was always checking, because I work in the city centre in my normal job. And so I'm round the corner from two or three of the ones on your app. And I'm very aware of both of them. One of them is the famous Boots Chemist on the High Street in Sheffield, which has a long-standing reputation. Now, one of my friends actually worked in there, and he thinks the paranormal and Fortean, it's all nonsense, Paul. But he wouldn't go in there. He wouldn't go in the basement. He said there was something in that basement that made everybody feel very uneasy. Some staff flatly refused to even go down the stairs into the basement. Everybody else kind of did their thing and got out of it and did what was what. And so when you see that kind of thing, and when somebody who isn't a believer at all tells you that it's a strange place, you give that kind of locality a bit more credence, I think, because I'm more liable to listen to somebody like that with that kind of attitude when it comes to the paranormal, far more than somebody that tells me that it's the disembodied spirit of Ethel, who was murdered in a lover's tryst that went horribly wrong in 1896, though there's no evidence to support any of that.
Yeah. It is very intriguing when people have this almost tangible feeling of fear or dread, but they don't know why. And is it something that they have picked up either through their senses, or is it by something that they've been told? And if it's something they've been told, does that have a basis in fact or reality, or is it just Chinese whispers? I say, during my research, I encountered quite a few places where the landlord said that their reputation as a haunted place is just based on hoaxes or misidentifications. But people still believe them, and they go in there and they're frightened by what they've encountered, even though it's bunkum what's been happening in the past. And the Chinese whispers have percolated throughout the media, the books, the magazines, the TV shows and whatever, and people are still printing it and they're still believing it. So I'm wondering if this chap in boots has heard this and it's been festering in the back of his mind in his subconscious, and he remembers something about it being perhaps a little bit edgy down there, but he can't quite remember why. It'd be interesting to know just why he feels this way. Is he being prompted by something that his senses are telling him, or by something he's half remembered? And I hear that quite a lot from people, a feeling of unease, and they just don't know why. Is it real or is it imagined? And it's fascinating. I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah. No, I'm the same, because like you say, you would suggest that someone of a sceptical slant of mind would not succumb to such feelings. But yet then that takes us into the realms of memory and psychology and the ambience of a place that can change someone's perception, even though if you ask them in their day-to-day lives, they would say, no, absolutely not. There's no ghosts. It's all rubbish.
Yeah, it could be a completely innocent physical phenomenon, like, well, infrasound's been bandied around a lot.
Yes.
It could be through electrostatic fields that are making you feel a bit edgy. It could be that they're experiencing a real physical effect, but not ghostly. So it's something that really does make the skin stand up on the arms. But it's a real physical effect rather than a spooky one.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course it is. And once again, it comes down to knowing the locality and having the tools available to be able to measure such things. Because once again, often people who will go hunting for ghosts will have no interest in those kinds of scientific phenomenon that can be explained, Paul, because that dissuades the argument that it's haunted.
Well, it would be interesting to take a completely virgin bystander or observer into these environments and seeing if they pick them up. So you have a few people for control purposes and other people just to go along and seeing if they pick up anything, either psychically or actual physical interaction with the environment. And then you could do the same kind of effect on a building which is definitely not haunted. And then you could do some kind of psychological experiment to see whether it's the actual building itself that gives the impression of being haunted. I mean, if you were to compare someone like the Ettington Park Hotel, which was used in the 1960s haunting film, which apparently had a few ghosts, it looks bloody well haunted.
Yes.
But if you came to a council house, they might not experience anything because they're not psychologically primed to believing that there's a ghost there. And that brings me back to something I found out in my book on West Norfolk ghosts, and it's probably the same across the whole spectrum of haunted places, in that even those innocuous locations can have ghost stories, even if the buildings are relatively brand new. Hmm. Like, I live in a housing estate that, until the late 1960s, was just fields. It was farmland and fields. And yet there are quite a few ghost stories from this neck of the woods. And I think, well, where the hell have the ghosts come from? There were no buildings here beforehand. And I've been playfully speculating that ghosts float around the cosmic ether looking for people or places to latch onto. Mm. And they sometimes don't tell truths. They tell a complete load of BS sometimes. But they're just looking for someone, regardless of their environment, to latch onto and play tricks on. There's a great example just up the road from me. It's less than 10 minutes walk away. And it's a house which has had some form of poltergeist behavior in the past. And the lady who lived there said that she used to be able to communicate with a ghost. And his name was Barney, which is a strange name. And he was a choir master at Norwich Cathedral. And she was absolutely sure of the details. He said he played the violin. He died of a heart attack. He had a wife and family who lived there. And she even described the colours of the robes that he used to wear. He said at Christmas time they were red. The rest of the year they were black. And I went to the housing registers. I contacted Norwich Cathedral. And I contacted the Choir Masters Association. I did everything I could to try and verify this story. And as far as I can gather, Barney never, ever existed. But she is quite sincere about what she experienced. So was she hoaxing or was she being misled by a mischievous ghost?
Hmm.
Because I can tell you one thing, Barney, it certainly isn't a choir master called Barney from Norwich. Never. And I found a few more places around here. Like there was an old lady who lived in a relatively new build from the 1960s, I think.
Hmm.
And she was really menacing and she wanted to try and harm the girl who lived there by throwing her downstairs. And they did a few Ouija board sessions. They found out her name, her age, and from when she appeared, they actually got a physical description of her. Now, the Ouija board sessions you could probably discount as being due to a fertile imagination, but the physical manifestations were a 81-year-old woman with a shawl overhead and 4'11", and her name was Atty and all this.
Hmm.
And if you go back through the housing records, there was no such person living there. So where the hell did this woman come from? And I thought, are these things just floating around and they're looking for vulnerable people just to latch onto and have a bit of a laugh at? Because the historical details they give are completely bogus.
Mm.
So that's what I say. You can look at a council house and say it doesn't look haunted. And then I thought, ah, yes, maybe it's not. But what if there's one of these floating spooks that want to attach themselves to it? Mm. So you can't tell.
Yeah. Well, I've often thought, Paul, that there are such things as haunted people, never mind haunted properties. I think one of the things, speaking from personal experience, I remember being interviewed for a book about ghosts in Sheffield when I was a publican. And I said, no, there's no ghosts in this pub at all. Never had, yeah. Never built. Imagine my surprise when the book was published and there was, you know. So that's always left me on a wry smell. That is now classed as a haunted pub in Sheffield. There's no evidence there, and it's one of those things that I was a bit disappointed with the person, because I knew the person who wrote the book, and so I don't understand why they just ignored what I said completely just to add to it. And it wasn't a very interesting story anyway, you know. It's just funny noises and things doing that. And when you work in pubs, the least frightening paranormal alleged event you could ever come across is a pint glass moving about or falling off a table, because if I had a pound for every pint glass that had exploded in my hands throughout my career in that particular field, Paul, I'd be a very rich man. I'd have better hands, but I'd be a very rich man. And it's this kind of thing when I see these videos of pint pots sliding along bars and things, I know how that works. I know what that is. I know how the temperatures and little scratches here and there can eventually just cause a glass to implode for no reason and things like that because of the temperature fluctuations that a glass goes through when in its working life. And so when I see things like that, then I go, no, that's not paranormal. But when I see a bottle leap, you know, 3 feet off a shelf to jump, that gets me interested. Exploding glasses, I'm just not interested in the slightest.
Yes. Well, the status quo of haunted locations can change quite a bit over the years.
Mm.
Some haunted in the 1960s or 70s might not be haunted anymore.
Yeah.
But, I did a survey a few years back, and I'm convinced that a lot of ghosts are just fading away. Mm. It's like they're running out of energy.
Yes.
So somewhere that appears in guidebooks from the 70s, it talks about the usual gamut of ghostly phenomena, might have nothing at all now, or it might be so low-key it could be just misinterpreted as something mundane. And I just remembered that when I was doing my research for the Haunted Hospitality Volume 2, I tried to contact as many haunted hotels and bed and breakfasts and Airbnbs and whatever as I possibly could to see if things have changed since the last survey, which was done 2 or 3 years previously. And they all came back, with a few exceptions, saying that nothing's changed, it's all quiet, it's just dead, no ghosts here. But a couple of places did come forward, and it's like the ghostly activity has gone from being nothing to very, very low key. So I was thinking, well, is it picking up again in these places? Has there been a change of personnel or perhaps renovation work that has rekindled the ghostly activity? But then comparing what was said a few years back to what was said in January and February this year when I redid my survey, it seems that what had happened was that there had been a change of personnel in most of these cases, and the people who are there now seem to be more receptive to the idea of ghosts than the previous proprietors. And the previous proprietors are probably more receptive to dismissing shadows or footsteps as a trick of the light or the house or the building settling at 3 o'clock in the morning. But the new proprietors are more interested in ghosts, and they're more keen to perhaps interpret these things, which could be mundane, as potentially spooky. Hmm. Now, I think that might have some kind of that might have some evidence going for it, based on the fact that what they're experiencing now is very low key. It hasn't gone from nothing to laughing cavaliers with their heads under their arms, for instance. It's gone from being nothing at all to footsteps or shadows or very mundane stuff. And I'm thinking, well, they're probably just seeing normal things, but their mind, their belief system is conditioning them to thinking that it might be ghosts when it's not. So again, that's the psychological aspect coming to the fore, maybe. But there's loads of places where you can say that grey lady walking down the staircase might be due to psychological priming. People expect to see a ghost. They're tired, or not, maybe had one beer too many, and they see this hallucination. But psychology can't explain when things fly off shelves.
No.
Or things disappear, like your book on poltergeist. That cannot be explained by trick of the mind.
Hmm.
And I've got so much anecdotal evidence and first-hand evidence from proprietors and guests who stopped at these places. And I think that it just cannot all be due to hallucinations or mental fogs.
Yeah.
Some of it inevitably must be.
Of course.
That's the way it works. I mean, the brain is so complicated. It's an incredibly complicated organ. It's bound to misfire sometimes. It is bound to hallucinate. It's inevitable because it's so complicated. But it can't explain poltergeist-like phenomena with things moving by themselves or people levitating. Here's a really good example. And if memory serves, it was the coach and horses in Chepstow. Now, the landlord said that he didn't believe in ghosts, but there's a caveat. He says he's experienced things that he just cannot explain. Things like he and his wife being in the hotel completely by themselves doing the laundry. And they folded the sheets and the towels up and put them on the bed. They'd go out into the hallway for a few minutes. They'd go back in and everything was scattered all over the floor, which was completely bizarre.
Mm.
And my most favourite anecdote that he told me was he said that the ghost or ghosts didn't seem to like men very much. A lot of the activity was focused on them. He said one night these two men were stopping in the haunted room. And when they woke up the next morning, they found the bedside cabinet had been turned 180 degrees completely around, so it now faced the wall, and neither of them heard a thing during the night. Now, psychology can't explain that.
No.
I actually spoke to this guy over the phone. A lot of the interviews I did were by email or information sheets, but this guy said, yes, call me up, we'll have a chat. And he told me this. And when he told me that, I think my blood ran a bit cold. I thought, bloody hell, that's a great story.
Yeah,
these two guys, bedside cabinet, turn around during the night and neither of them heard a thing.
Brilliant. I suppose as well, Paul, with the books that you've released so far, I mean, I recommend all of your work extremely highly because I think... Along with perhaps Ruth Roper Wilde, who is someone I know that you've conversed with as well, that I think between you both, you're kind of covering and chronicling a lot of places and stories and encounters that would have just dropped by the wayside. Because, I mean, the thing about your books is they are phenomenal in their breadth and length that you've gone to investigate and chase down these leads, Paul. As pandemic hobbies go, it's one of the biggest ones I've ever seen. The amount of time and diligence that you must have undertook to complete them is incalculable, I would imagine. And so I think they're fascinating because anybody that's have an interest in the paranormal of a balanced mind would be selling themselves short if they didn't have your books amongst their collections, Paul, because they give you probably something that hasn't been done to that level. Because there'll be people who you might have to buy every ghost book that comes out, all these local haunted guides for every major city in the UK. Whereas when you get a book like yours or one that Ruth does as well, you can get a whole smorgasbord of paranormal encounters from all over. And so it's a wonderful resource just to flick through and find your local areas and then spread out a bit. So were you, when you settled back and thought, what am I going to do with all this data? Were you a little daunted to have so much? Because, you know, both books are very weighty tomes, but not that is a negative. I think it's fascinating. I'm one of those people, the more pages of information you give me, Paul, the more happy I am.
Well, I think when I was compiling the data, in the back of my mind was always the thought that a lot of these stories are decades old. I've tried to focus on things from the 1970s or 80s onwards, so there's nothing really, really ancient in there. I wanted people to go to these locations with a feeling that they might encounter a ghost. So there's not much point putting a building that's been demolished in the 1700s down because there's nothing there to see. So I thought I will compile all these different kinds of hostelries and hotels and whatever, which have had at least two phenomena reported since the 1970s or 80s. I didn't want to focus on one-offs because they could be anything. But while going through it, I thought it's not good enough just to list historical information. What we should really be doing is finding out the current status quo of these places. Like, has anything been experienced recently? So I did my survey a few years back and I started contacting thousands and thousands of locations across the whole board, not just hotels and pubs, but theatres and museums, all kinds of stuff, coffee shops, tea houses, restaurants, whatever, you name it. I tried to contact them all and I got some response from some of them. But my impetus was I wanted to give people an idea as to whether these places are still haunted, and if so, what can we expect? So I didn't want people to go into these things feeling and coming out afterwards feeling disappointed that nothing had happened if they've been quiet for decades. The place that I've talked about have had some very, very recent stuff. So I'd like people to go into them knowing that I've at least made the effort to try and give them value for money, that it's not just a historical recitation of old ghost stories. I wanted to try and make them think this is up to date as far as I can. And hopefully go into these places and maybe find a spook or two. but also another thing that jumped to mind when I was doing it was when I was doing my survey, it was hampered by the COVID pandemic.
Hmm.
In fact, my research was just stopped for about a year. It came in leaps and bounds. But I thought a lot of these places are really going to need some kind of financial help when the pandemic's over. And I thought, if I can encourage people to actually go to these haunted locations in the chance of learning a bit of history of the place, doing a bit of exploring, and maybe seeing a ghost and supporting these establishments, then that's not a bad thing, in my opinion.
I agree.
Or does that sound completely cynical?
No, not at all. I think, as with anything, Paul, when you go to certain, like I say, I know York very well because one of my best friends lived there for several years. So most of York's most haunted pubs I've been in, and certainly probably felt a little more open-minded when I left them than I did when I went in. But that might be due to the refreshment I imbibed during my time inside them, especially the Golden Fleece, which is a pub that has its tongue firmly in its cheek in regards to its paranormal history with the skeletons that sit at the bar. And so I think for me, I think there are some places, you know, I've been to loads of pubs over the years, and some because they're haunted and some because their reputation precedes them. And more often than not, I would probably say I've never seen anything strange. It's been a couple of odd things here and there down the years, but nothing overall. And so I think when you've had the businesses have had the challenges, I mean, a lot of pubs were struggling anyway prior to the pandemic because of changes in legislation and cultural shifts in regards to how people go out these days and how people view going out for a drink and what they do these days compared to sort of how it was 30, 40 years ago. I mean, some of the old drink driving beer mats you used to see, that when you see them now, you think, gee, blimey, when it's like four's enough, four pints and no more. You're like, what? but that's just how it was. And so sometimes you'll find these, especially rural locations, as you will know very well, especially where you're located, and it's the same not far from here, Paul. You get to a certain edge of the Peak District and, you know, you can drive for ages and not see anything but a pub. They're the places that are going to be challenged. And so I think it's nice to see a positive change occur for that kind of thing. Like you say, and yes, it could be cynical, but I think certain pubs do need some help. But I don't think they would necessarily think, oh, the only way I can save my business is to pretend there's a ghost here either. So I can kind of play devil's advocate there, because I think some people would sort of lean into it a bit more just for that. But others will probably think it's the last thing they think they need to do. They're more interested in trying to perhaps get Singer's Elm or try and do a new food menu rather than say, well, this is the ghost of Brian who used to be the cellar man here.
Yeah, well, it does work both ways, but I would encourage people to get out and explore, not just the ones in my books, but also maybe just ask a few questions in your local. You never know what you might find. You might find a completely new ghost or story that has not been recorded anywhere, and that could be added to our sum total of ghostly knowledge.
Mm.
So what I'm saying is that get out and explore and learn a bit of history of these places. Talk to the landlord, not just about ghosts, but, you know, just learn the history of these things. A lot of them are fascinating locations. And the landlord, the publican, will probably be very happy to be talked to about not only the ghosts, but the history of the place. But on the other hand, putting that to one side, you do get the greedy publicans who take it too far the other way. have been the ones who charge for the ghost hunts, and they charge like 30, 40, 50, 60 pounds a head to spend all night in a haunted room, which may or may not be haunted, but which brings them money. Now, these are the disreputable, greedy proprietors we're talking about. And I've come across quite a few of those in my time. So it works both ways. You get the innocent publican who will happily tell you about the ghosts while you have a pint and a pie or something. And then you get the ones who just have pound signs flashing in front of their eyes and the greedy opportunists maybe should be ignored or at least mentioned publicly to as places to avoid.
Yes. Well, Paul, it's been fascinating to finally have a conversation with you. I hope it's not the last time I speak to you. And I'm always intrigued into what projects you've got in the paranormal pipeline coming down. So where's the best place for everybody to track down everything we've mentioned? You've got the three books, you've got your ghost map, and also this wonderful ghost app.
Well, everything is on my website, which is paullee.com/ghosts. It has all my research I've done over the years. It has links to books and also recommended books that I've read and enjoyed or my friends have written, which I think other people might like. And they've got links to Amazon pages as well. So just paullee.com/ghosts and everything is there.
That's brilliant. I'll put a link to everything in the show. That's brilliant. I'll put a link to everything in the show notes for you, Paul. And I just want to thank you once again for both speaking to me today and releasing and collating these valuable troves of paranormal data in the United Kingdom. And I wish you the very best of luck. And like I said, I hope to speak to you in the future.
Well, I'm pleased you like the books and it's kindled me into perhaps restarting my research career. I've got some ideas, but I'm having a little bit of a break at the moment because being close to Halloween, I'm just being swamped with media and projects and I need a bit of a break for a month or two.
Nothing wrong with that. Well, take care and thank you again for your time, Paul.
Cheers. Thanks a lot. Thank you.